Thank you very much for having us here to give a very brief reflection on Pakistan, a resolution which will be coming shortly. So be prepared for a journey which will be slightly turbulent and not a pleasant one. But be ready for it so early in the morning. I begin with the 78th Episcopal Convention, the opening Eucharist, the message of the Eucharist, which in my understanding began with terms of construction, of laborers, of moving towards a pilgrimage, towards a destination. I thought that is how I understood the presiding bishop. Turn the difficult terrain into a straight road. We're journeying together will lead the creation of God into experiencing the reign of God. A concept which, in my opinion, was leading towards development and sustainability, was leading towards peace and justice, equality and tolerance, forgiveness and acceptance, thus ultimately trying to live together in the household of God. Further, I believe yesterday set the trend, gave a vision of strengthening and prioritizing our perspective of the work of God, clarifying the mission of the church, the marks of mission. And bearing this in mind, my emphasis this morning is to emphasize the transformation of the unjust structures to challenge violence of every kind, pursuing for peace and reconciliation within the context of Pakistan, so that a straight road could be built. I will try to share this so that the Pakistan resolution, and I repeat this with extreme strength, the Pakistan resolution, which is coming before the convention for the third time in 15 years. This is not the first time that this resolution is coming. This is the third time that this resolution is coming. The first one beginning in 2000, 2009, and 2015 will not end up in just bringing another fourth resolution of this kind, but will be a real mission action. Pakistan. Let's go to Pakistan. Pakistan, the second largest Islamic country, gives a dominant view that as a Muslim country, it should protect the interests of the Muslims. Religion has always had a prominent role in the polity of Pakistan. The situation has been translated something like this: a state which was looking for a religion, and now religion is looking for a state. The misuse of religion for purposes of authority and power introduced and strengthened religious militancy. In a situation of such nature, the existence of Christians and other non-Islamic faiths are placed in a very vulnerable and uncomfortable situation. Our life, our property, our families, our worship places, our friends, our guests, our friend from the Episcopal Church here sitting behind me are not secure people in that country. There is a constant fear. In the past, 10 to 15 years, people worshiping in the church have been killed while worshiping. They have been burnt alive. Last year, a couple was burnt alive. Villages have been burnt altogether. Holy books and liturgical books have been burnt. Churches have been bombed. Christian housing areas and semi-urban areas have been burnt. Land and homes of the people have been taken. Religious extremism has become prominent because violent acts are being done under its domain to attract attention and spread fear amongst the people. In the name of security, the Pakistani society is becoming weaponized. You are de-weaponizing the United States. We are weaponizing. So there is a good market here. I must express here that a common question which is often asked to me, especially in the West, when there are extremist strands in all religions, we find extremists in all religions, why are Muslim extremists profiled as terrorists? Good question. Let me try to answer that very briefly. One of the reasons is that Muslim terrorists are more in number and they are spread in many parts of the world, both in the north and in the south. They are organized and can fight a trick with a trained national army. And above all, the Al-Qaeda and now the ISIS has given them a global agenda. This is about the Islamic religious extremists. But to be fair, let's give some breathing space to Islam and to the majority of the Muslims. Let us be mindful that it would be wrong to think that religious extremism is a peculiar problem of the Muslims. The incidents of the Emmanuel African Methodist Episcopal Church in South Carolina is still very fresh in our memories and speaks a lot. With this in the background, is there a way forward? Is there a hope? Our strength and our hope lies in making the straight road, in caring for our neighbors, in living the Christ's way of life, forgiving as sisters and brothers in the AME church did. As the Aga Khan Muslims, a Sunni sect, did when over 40 of their people, mostly young women, were shot dead by members of the ISIS almost 4 weeks ago. There are multiple reasons for religious discrimination. Violence and rise of religious extremism in Pakistan. It butts from a fact that the Muslim ulama, that is the religious leaders, want to turn the country into a theocratic state. Law passed by the parliament leading to religious extremism. And here I want to mention the infamous blasphemy laws. I know most of you have heard about it, but some of you may not have heard of the infamous, unpopular blasphemy laws passed by the parliament of the country, which says that if anyone says anything contrary to the nature and character of the Prophet of Islam, there is no question for him but to die, for him or her. This law in its present form was introduced during the 1970s. The law is misused. Even up to date, people are put behind bars, killed and forced to leave their historical places. of living. Judges have been killed if they have spoken for justice on this law. 2 years ago, one of the governors of the largest province of Pakistan, or the most populated province of Pakistan, was murdered. Social activists have been killed. Men and women and children have been killed because of this law. And the most unfortunate thing is that the killers go free because they are protecting the nature and the character of the Prophet Islam. No judge today or a good lawyer is willing to take a case which is related to blasphemy. And the victims of blasphemy, of course there are Muslims, but comparing the percentage of Christians in Pakistan, we are more affected than the Muslims, the non-Muslims. So what do we require? Strong advocacy against this law with the parliament, with governments overseas, to support, train, and protect lawyers to contest such criminal and false cases, to help and encourage the church in Pakistan to rehabilitate the victims of blasphemy laws. Frequent misuse of the blasphemy laws has made its victim of not being able to freely move in the society. It is not an, brothers and sisters, for me, now in Pakistan, a country where I have lived the most part of my life, the issue is not an issue of identity anymore. The issue is not that of security. The issue is that of my entire existence. It's an existential issue for the entire church and the non-Muslims in that country. The second issue, it's a big issue, I'm not taking a long time. We can talk if you are more interested later on these issues. The second one is migration. What has the entire situation led? The Christians of Pakistan voted for the independence of Pakistan. Those of you who know the history of India and Pakistan will know that the deciding vote came from the non-Muslims for the creation of Pakistan. And today, Christians in thousands are migrating from the country to an unknown future. They are just leaving the country, wherever little space they get. And a large number of Christians are now found in Sri Lanka, Malaysia, and Thailand. They are not in the refugee camps. With no future, no clarity of what the future would hold for them. Thirdly, as we make the road straight, our issue is the issue of economic sustainability of our people. Unemployment, of course, is a national problem, but is more so for non-Muslims and religious minorities. So one of the options that we have as a church is to give more dignity, to encourage our people to struggle on and find options and opportunities for them to be a viable community of self-employment, of learning simple trades. It's not an expensive job. A $3,000 investment on a particular person for self-employment can feed a family of five for the rest of their life. And that's the kind of context I'm talking about. That's the hope of the church. The great strength which lies for us, the positivity which lies in the midst of this hopelessness and this suffering, is our interfaith initiatives. Very important for our survival. Very, very necessary for our survival. Although the majority of our people feel that why should we talk with people who are exploiting us or oppressing us? We had 2 bomb attacks 4 months ago in 2 churches in Lahore. 2 years ago, a church in Peshawar was blasted up. There was no accusation here. People just came out of the worship and they were dead. They're still under medical care. Peshawar and Lahore, many of these. And besides that, the things that follows is the uncruel attitude of the bureaucracy, the police, in dealing with such cases. What is the way forward? There are a lot of way forward, brothers and sisters. Strengthening of partnership. Joint activities with the Muslims. Visits from the Episcopal Church to Pakistan. It's very easy for me to hear when I come on the land of the United States of America for friends coming up and telling me, Bishop, we are praying for you. And we feel so bad for you as we see and hear about what is happening in your country. And I'm grateful for that. And I'm grateful for the prayers that you do. But it will encourage us more if we have delegations, if we have the accompaniment of partner churches in our time of grief and pain. Very seldom does that happen. Very, very seldom. When one part of the body suffers, says the Bible, the other body also feels the pain. I know we all feel the pain. But if there is death in my family, I expect my partner, I expect my neighbor to sit with me at least 5 minutes, if not more. And that does not happen. That's the way forward. Advocacy. Episcopal Church, by God's grace, has a base of speaking for the world. You have a strong base in Washington. Advocacy for the minorities. Friends, we have a relationship. We have a very loose relationship. We have a very flirting relationship between the Church of Pakistan and the Episcopal Church. We need to get more serious in our relationship with each other. We need to understand what partnership is in church relationships. Please guide us, help the church to move from dependency to confidence. We have been a colonial church, somehow or the other, that still merges out of us. From preaching to building relationships, from being a saved community to recognize the love and the grace of God upon His entire creation. May God help the Episcopal Church, and may God help the Church of God. The instruments of justice and peace in this tremendous, difficult pilgrimage where the terrain is very rough. Let us hear what my wife has to say. She probably will speak more from the gender perspective. Thank you for hearing me.
Thank you for giving me this opportunity to share how women in Pakistan are affected by religious extremism. Violence is often inflicted by religious extremists to silence women and vulnerable communities in Pakistan. Abduction of young women of religious minorities, particularly Hindus and Christians, and their forced conversion to Islam is a form of violence committed against women. Most of these young girls come from poor family backgrounds and are not able to defend themselves. As you've heard, blasphemy laws are often abused to target poor women of religious minorities in Pakistan. There are many examples I can give. However, I would like to share two of them. Rimsha, a teenage Christian girl, was falsely accused by a Muslim cleric of burning pages of the Holy Quran in 2012. Later on, it was discovered that the cleric had fabricated evidence, and so the case against Rimsha was dropped. The incident created fear amongst Christians of that community. About 300 Christian families were forced to leave their homes for safety reasons. And many a times, incidents like this happen to target vulnerable communities, particularly Christians, so they can vacate those communities. Rimsha and her family fled from Pakistan for their safety and were given asylum by Canada. Second example is that of Asiya Bibi, a 50-year-old Christian woman, mother of five, is given death sentence following an incident in 2009 where she was harvesting berries with a group of Muslim women. They accused her of drinking water from the same bowl which they used for themselves. In many areas in Pakistan, Christians cannot eat or drink from the same bowl as they are considered unclean and unholy. After having an argument over the use of the bowl, they all went home. But the next day, the Muslim women ganged up against Asiya Bibi. They went to their local cleric and reported that Asiya Bibi had blasphemed against Islam and its prophet. A mob came to her house and arrested her. Asiya Bibi, who was falsely accused, marks 6 years of brutal imprisonment and is placed on death row. Her health has deteriorated. She is suffering from a number of health problems, including intestinal bleeding and having trouble walking. Today I speak as a Pakistani Christian American woman who is blessed to be ordained priest of the Episcopal Church, a privilege which Pakistani women do not have. I'm so grateful to the Episcopal Church for embracing me and giving me the confidence to speak up against these unjust practices. I feel blessed to be a part of a church that has always challenged its leaders and members to take a bold step, to raise their prophetic voice against injustice, inequality, discrimination, oppression, and violence, and to stand in solidarity with those who feel marginalized, who are struggling in the desert, to move forward in faith, to build new roads of understanding, partnership, peace, justice, and reconciliation. And this is the need of Pakistan. As the presiding bishop said yesterday, the road will be built by the bruised. The road will be built by the sweat and tears of the oppressed. Dear brothers and sisters, the Church of Pakistan is ready to make the way and is requesting the Episcopal Church to stand in solidarity with the religious minorities, particularly the Christians of Pakistan, in this road building task. Let us walk together in faith, knowing that our loving God will surely join us in